Our next speaker is Dr. Ashwin Gandhi, who will be dealing on working up of patients with suspected traumatic optic neuropathy. The what, when, and how. So we look forward to hearing from you, Dr. Ashwin.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I would like to thank AIOS, ARC, Dr. Chitra, Murli, and the entire team for inviting me for this presentation. There are basically three questions in traumatic optic neuropathy. What investigation would I order? Would it be CT scan or MRI scan? What's the role of electrodiagnostics? And the perennial question, is there any role of steroids in traumatic optic neuropathy? Whether any surgical intervention be useful? Let's look at the first one. CT versus MRI in the case with traumatic optic neuropathy. Well, a lot of times you are looking for fracture of the optic canal, and that will show up nicely on CT scan. So CT scan of brain with orbit, fine cuts through orbit, and this is something which has to be mentioned, is a lot of times comprehensive ophthalmologist will order for CT scan of brain. You will be able to see orbit, but it'll because of the change in angulation, you'll not be able to see details. So a CT scan of brain with orbit, fine cuts would be the first investigation of choice. You need to look at the coronal images as well. The MRI will show up the edema of optic nerve and optic nerve sheath enhancement or hemorrhage of the in the optic nerve sheath. So basically both CT and MRI has a role to play. CT is the investigation of choice, but a lot of times to rule out retrobulbar hemorrhage in the optic nerve sheath or the edema of the optic nerve, you end up requesting for MRI with contrast as well. So that's about the CT versus MRI. What's the role of VEP? Well, there is enough evidence, and intuitively you know that if VEP is normal on presentation, you know that probably the prognosis for improvement in those patients is not very good. However, there has been a paper from Chandigarh about a couple of decades ago, where they said that even a flat VEP on presentation in patients with traumatic optic neuropathy, they did see some improvement later on as the disease progressed. But by and large, and as this paper suggested, VEP amplitudes, which are you require at least 50% of amplitude compared to the normal eye for a good visual outcome. So would I do VEP in all patients who comes to me with traumatic optic neuropathy? The other important angle that we need to remember in these patients is that a lot of these patients would end up having a medico-legal aspect, a traumatic optic neuropathy, and VEP would be a good documentation in those patients. Now, coming to the third question about the treatment. So is there any evidence-based treatment in patients with traumatic optic neuropathy? Well, the short answer is no. A long answer is yes, maybe, could be. So let's look at all the papers which have studied this aspect of the treatment. This was a paper by Alfredo Sadur and group in 1996. They studied 58 patients with traumatic optic neuropathy. There were 10 patients who were observed, 23 were treated with corticosteroids, and 25 had both optic canal decompression and corticosteroids. And the third group who had both the intervention actually had the most visual improvement versus 10 patients who were observed, they didn't see any improvement in those patients. So if you look at this paper in isolation and say, oh, you have to intervene in all patients with traumatic optic neuropathy, and both surgery and steroids have role to play. This is Len Levin and the International Optic Nerve Trauma Study, which actually didn't do well because of less recruitment of patients. And their conclusion was there is sufficient evidence to conclude that neither of the treatment modality can be considered as standard of care. So since 1990, there are more than 16 major studies which have been done in traumatic optic neuropathy. Most of them had some flaws, and that's because of the nature of the disease, variable weak design, retrospective, small sample sizes, no controls, non-standardized outcomes. And what happened in these studies? Well, these are the studies where they proclaim that some form of intervention improved the outcome, and there is a wide variability. You see the percentages are wide, telling you that there is no consensus. The similar kind of percentages were observed even in the group where they said that observation alone is sufficient. Keeping that in mind, I would like to emphasize on these two studies. This is by Kenneth Steinsiper. It was a study done in the labs. The conclusion, they had divided these animals into five groups. one group received only saline, and then they had a progressive increase of the steroid dosage. And what they concluded is that there was a greatest number of exonal survival in patients who did not receive steroids. And as the dose of steroids increased, the exonal survival reduced. So if you look at this lab study, it tells you that higher dose steroids actually might be reducing the exonal survival at the end of 6 weeks. A similar kind of conclusion was in this crash trial, which actually had to be abandoned, where there is a mega dose steroids which was given in patients with the head injury. And we found that there was an increased risk of death within 2 weeks in patients who received these steroids versus compared with placebo.
1 minute.
Yeah, I'll conclude with this patient just to highlight the importance of history and clinical examination, which cannot be replaced. And this was shared with me by Dr. Naveen Jay Kumar, where he had seen a patient who came to him for a second opinion. The history was there was a repeated injury to the head and eyesight gradually fell down. And this is how the optic nerves looked like. But because there was a gradually progressive loss of vision, he went ahead and did the MRI and actually it showed presence of pituitary adenoma. Went ahead and saw the optic disc and saw that there is a surely a pale disc on the affected side, but there are also a bow tie kind of optic atrophy on the other side, telling you that there was a chiasmal compression. So in other words, vision loss, the history of vision loss and optic nerve function test are of paramount importance in all these patients. To summarize, it's a clinical diagnosis. Life-threatening and globe-threatening injuries would be handled first. Surgical indications are limited. Risk-benefit ratio of steroids, megadose steroids, I think is no-no. No clear evidence-based recommendation can be given, and no standard of care actually is established. I thank you once again.
So after you have given your, thank you very much, your talk was amazing, but after you gave your talk, I still don't understand one thing. What is your regimen for giving steroids in traumatic optic injury, and what is your criteria for optic canal decompression? Yeah. If there is a fracture.
So as I said, not only you, nobody understands traumatic optiopathy to actually give a standardized or to give evidence-based evidence-based recommendation. What is being followed by a lot of us would be if the patient comes in acute phase, and now how acute, again, that is debatable, but let's say patient comes in first 8 hours or first 24 hours, he ends up getting IV steroids, 1 gram, no megadose, 1 gram, 3 to 5 days followed by oral steroids. Patient comes within 1 week with guarded prognosis. Again, he gets 1 gram steroids. After 1 week, role of steroids seems to be debatable, though there have been anecdotal cases where even steroid after 1 week had shown some improvement. But we have to also understand that a lot of these patients have spontaneous recovery, up to 1/3 or more would have a spontaneous recovery. So it's very difficult to prove whether steroids caused that recovery or whether there was a spontaneous recovery. As far as the surgical intervention is concerned, there has been a recent paper in Indian Journal of Ophthalmology by Dr. Kasturi from Assam. So she has been doing this optic canal decompression, navigation-guided optic canal decompression, and around, I think, she published around 31 or 32 patients, and she has proclaimed a good recovery of vision with optic canal decompression, even in the absence of a bone fragment sitting on the optic nerve. And her theory is that because it's navigation-guided, it's more controlled. And it relieves that edema at the narrowest part of the orbit. And whatever vision which is lost because of edema of the optic nerve, it covers.
So let's add to the confusion, if I may. If I may take a second here, I'll add to the confusion. In 2018, there was a study in Iran, a very well-designed and prospective study of 52 patients who were given erythropoietin IV in the first few days following the trauma. And the outcomes, and this was 3 days of IV erythropoietin, and the outcomes at the end of 1 month, 3 months, 6 months was just similar to corticosteroids IV or even observation. This is called the traumatic optic neuropathy treatment trial.
So any other questions to ask, or shall I go on to our next speaker? That was a very nice brief talk by you, Dr. Ashmin. It was very informative. As what